singing. So come on. He's still the Lord Almighty. He's still the King of Kings. He's still the raging Savior, reigning over everything. His name is still the highest. His strength will never fail. His word is everlasting, yesterday, today, and forever. The faith, fan the flame, don't give up the fight. In the night, speak his name, his hope is alive. Our hope is alive. Oh, my soul, come on, remember who you're singing to. Take on, hold on,
come on. All of our hope and all of our trust in Jesus today.
Jesus, Jesus, the one I can count on, the one thing I'm sure of. Jesus, Jesus, the rock that I stand on, I stake my
and oh my soul, remember what you're singing to. Remember, remember, and oh my soul, remember who you're singing to.
Good morning, friends. Welcome. So good to see you. Glad you're here. And those of you that are online with us today, so good to have you here. If you're in the gathering area, come on in. Let's hear God call us to worship through his word in Psalm 99. Exalt the Lord your God. Worship at his footstool. He is holy. Exalt the Lord your God. Worship at his holy mountain, for he is holy. Amen. Let's stand together. We've come here to worship a holy God. He's so good. Things that he's done for us and for who he is in our lives. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. O my soul. I worship his holy name.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Chapter 9. Read together. Stand up and bless the Lord your God forever and ever. Blessed be your glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You have made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their hosts, the earth and everything on it, the seas and all that is in them. And you preserve them all. The host of heaven worships you. Blessed be your glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise. Lord, we worship you. We love you. We sing our songs this morning. We come before you. We open our hearts and our minds to your Holy Spirit. Move in us. Help us to be glorifying and to honor you with our decisions, with our movements, with our prayers, with our thoughts, with everything that happens in this service. May you be glorified. Speak to us, O Lord. It is you that we love. Oh, Jesus, we love you with all our heart. In your name we pray, amen.
Now.
love you with our lives. We'll love you in death with every beat of our hearts, with all that we are. We want to serve you. We want to worship you. We want to share you. We want to help change the world. In the name of Jesus. Father, we read your word and we see the miracles. We see that after the did the Sermon on the Mount, and you came down and you walked among the people and you touched the leper. And we believe that you healed them. And all the stories, all the testimonies in your word of people that you touched and you moved in. And Lord, we believe all those. Lord, we thank you for your spirit at work in our lives today. We think of this this time, this era, and we think it's troubled, it's crazy, it's upside down, and it is, but it's no different than it's always been. And we look to you. You are our steadfast hope. You are the truth, and you are the way. And Lord, we come to honor you today and to worship you. May you be pleased. In your name we pray. Amen. It's a song we've done once, I think. It's a great song. Always. God is always full of grace and love in our lives.
I believe you gave sight to the blind. I believe that the dead came to life. I believe there were wonders and signs, and you're still the same. I believe every word that you said. I believe there are scars in your hands, that your goodness is good without end, and you'll never change. I will tell you wonders, sing of your grace, the God of creation, he knows me by name. The Lord is faithful, yesterday, now, and always, always. Your mercy is mighty, age after age, and all generations will bow down.
yesterday, now, and always. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We're so happy to have you today. If you are new, if you're a guest, you're going to find one of these connect cards in your bulletin this morning. We would love for you to fill that out for us and turn it in at the connect desk as you leave. We have a gift for you. If you are not new, if you're not a guest, pull out that connect card. You can do that right now. Fill in, maybe you have a new address, a new email, some new information you'd like to share with us. Fill that out and take it to the connect desk. We're so happy to have you here this morning. This October, we have a group of men headed to North Carolina to the JARS headquarters. JARS is an organization that works closely with Wycliffe Bible Translators to help get the Word of God to many remote areas in the world. And so we have a group of men going this fall. If you would like to join in that, they would love to have you come along. They're looking for some guys who could come help do some pretty large projects and help around the area there in North Carolina. You can contact Bob. Do that by this weekend because they need to know quickly. School is right around the corner, and we love that we get to partner with some students in Detroit to support them with backpacks. So you can pick up your backpack and school supply list at the Connect Desk today. You can get it online on your weekly email. Go and fill up some backpacks for our students in Detroit. You can turn them in by August 24th. We can't wait. As we draw closer to September, we are looking at midweek coming back as well. And one of the best parts of midweek is dinner. In order to make dinner happen, we need more volunteers. And if you're coming anyways, come help us with some of the awesome food that we get to serve. You can sign up for one Wednesday a month, maybe with your small group, maybe with a friend. You can do that right now at our serve page or in your app under the volunteer tab. You can also get a hold of Scott Sexton. He would love to hear from you. Let's serve dinner together. This Wednesday, it's summer nights, and we're having a cornhole tournament. We have 16 team spots for you guys to sign up, so go do that. You can do that in the events tab. Grab a friend, you'll win a prize. But we also need more cornhole sets. So if we could get three of you guys to give us some of your sets for this Wednesday, we would love that. You can come find me after church or contact the office. It's gonna be a great night. We got stuff for the kids, stuff for the whole family. Come on out on Wednesday. And don't forget, August 13th, we're having our Community Grands Field Day. Get signed up for that in our events page. It's gonna be a fun time with Grandma and Grandpa and all the kids out on the lawn. Our Guatemala team left very early this morning, so don't forget to be praying for them this week. It's gonna be amazing to hear what they learn when they get back. If you'd like to give toward any of these awesome ministries that are happening here and just being an integral part of what God is doing at Trinity, you can do that very easily in our app, at our website, or in the gathering space at our giving boxes. And now let's get into our sermon series, You've Got Questions.
Well, good morning. I'm Mark, and it's good to be here with you today. I've been gone for a couple weeks, taking my last two classes for a doctorate ministry program out at Denver Seminary. So good. 2 years of thesis ahead of me now. So I'm excited about that. You want to hear a cool God story, though, to start out? You heard Dana say on the screen that our team left for Guatemala early this morning, and I found out from somebody here this morning already, they were stuck in Detroit, weren't going to make it to Atlanta on time. They were going to miss their flight to Guatemala. One of the gals from our church made a phone call to a friend who just happened to miss that flight yesterday to Guatemala, was on the flight today that we're supposed to go out, talked to the airline, let them know what was going on. They switched gates so that they could be right next to where our team was going to come in and delayed the flight. And so our team is on the plane or in the way. Isn't that awesome? So it's great to hear that news and just know that God is at work. And so we're thankful for that team. So we're going to keep praying for them for a great trip. And while I was gone, we had two more sermons in this series we've called You Got Questions. And the whole idea was we ask a number of our college students that are part of our church, part of our great church family, what are some of the issues that you're facing? What are some of the doubts maybe that you have about faith, with some of those tricky issues to work with? What are some of the issues that maybe you're talking with friends and they're struggling with? And it turns out the five questions that they gave to us, which were the top ones, are actually pretty common of all generations. And so week one, we tackled the idea of the church. Are we full of hypocrites? Are we holy and set apart? And we said definitively that the answer is yes, we're both. That's just because these are tough issues. They're tricky to work through. For 2 weeks then, we looked at the idea of hell. How is it that God could make a hell where people could be separated from him forever? Is that possible? What does that mean? Why would that be? Last week, we talked about Scripture, and is it accurate? Can we trust the Bible? Next week, we're going to come at the issue of suffering. If God is good, as the question goes, how is it that there's so much suffering in this world, so much evil? How could God allow that to happen? So that's an easy one to tackle. And today, we're going to tackle another easy one, science and faith. Does science actually disprove Christianity? I want to just work with you for a second, because many of us have had conversations like this. After the service this morning, several people came up and they said, yeah, this is something that's active in my life. I talk about this with coworkers, and I'm really thankful for some of the things that we talked about today, but they're not easy, so we're going to give each other lots of grace, right? The answer is yes. So maybe you've heard things like this. These are two quotes I want to give you right at the beginning that are in favor of the idea that, yes, science and faith are mutually incompatible, and maybe they're even at war with one another. The first one comes from Jerry Coyne, who wrote a book, Faith Versus Fact, Why Science and Religion Are Incompatible. And he says this, religion and science are engaged in a kind of war, a war between rationality and superstition. Religion is but a single brand of superstition. Others include beliefs in astrology, paranormal phenomena, homeopathy, spiritual healing. But it is the most widespread and harmful form of superstition. Richard Dawkins, who wrote a book called The God Delusion, he was part of the New Atheist movement. He's since passed away. But he wrote this, faith is the great cop-out, the great excuse to evade the need to think and evaluate evidence. Faith is belief in spite of, even perhaps because of, the lack of evidence. Maybe you've had those conversations. Maybe you've encountered people. Maybe there's something in you that you wrestle with the idea. Like, I heard a college professor say once, or I heard coworkers say, or I've read books, and I'm not quite so certain that faith and science can be reconciled. And that's an active struggle for you. And I just want to talk through that with you today. There was an anonymous college student, not one of ours, but they said this. Basically, I feel that religion outgrew its usefulness when science became as accurate as it is today. And a lot of people my age think that way. I'll never believe anything I won't see. I'll never have true faith in anything. I've had several people ask me over the years, as I've had interactions with neighbors, co-workers before I became a pastor, and one of the issues for them was, what about evolution? How is it that you can reconcile biblical faith with evolution? Because it seems like there's this mountain of evidence for the evolution of all things, and for the age of the universe, and all sorts of different things like that. And you can be excused for understanding why there's so much conflict, potentially. In fact, there's even conflict sometimes within families. One young boy came to his dad, and he asked his dad, Dad, where did human beings come from? And his dad said, well, son, we're descended from apes. And so he went to his mom, and he said, Mom, where do human beings come from? And his mom just lovingly held his face in her hands and said, Son, human beings are made by God in his image. And the son was a little confused, and so he said to his mom, but Mom, Dad said that we're descended from apes. And so the mom said what you would say if you were in that situation. Well, son, he's talking about his side of the family. Even within families, right, there can be some conflict. So we're going to give each other some grace. And here's my background, just so you know. Lots of you have known me for a while, but you know that I have a Master of Divinity from a great evangelical conservative seminary, Denver Seminary. I love Scripture. I love Jesus. I love God. I'm pro all of those things. One of the greatest compliments I feel like I've ever received as a pastor came at the end of a funeral at the other end of our building, and I just preached Jesus, and I was all over it. I mean, the Spirit was moving, it felt like, and I overheard somebody after the funeral service talking to somebody else, and it wasn't necessarily a compliment in their mind, but they said, boy, he really takes his religion seriously, doesn't he? Like, I love that. So 100%, like, I believe that we ought to be always having our Bibles open in front of us, listening to God, asking God for direction, trusting Jesus, all those things. I'm also very pro-science. I have a Master of Science in Engineering, a Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering from the University of Michigan. This is an awesome time to be alive. I follow science, and it's one of my feeds on Google. I'm always looking at different discoveries and looking at the astronomy, what's going on right now. It's super cool. Three of our three kids went into study biology and nursing, and our doctor and nurse and a dentist. So hard sciences, applied sciences. I'm all over science. So that's who I am. And yet I'm not a scientist. I don't pretend to be one. I don't play one on TV. So some of you in this room have forgotten way more about science than I'll ever know. So we're going to give each other grace and just talk through this issue today of faith and science, because one of my core convictions, and I'll just share, I'm going to have one main point today, one main takeaway. We'll maybe bust two myths, that's what I really would like to do, and then have three personal reflections at the end. But my one main point is just this: when rightly understood, science and faith do not conflict. When rightly understood, science and faith do not conflict. And I can see why a lot of people say that. I can see why a lot of people think, especially when it comes to like how long the universe has been around or origins of things, of life, and like that there's this huge war between faith and science. But I don't believe that that's true. We don't need to make that jump, because when rightly understood, science and faith don't conflict with one another. In fact, they should complement one another. Science ought to be this art which helps us to understand the majesty and the greatness and the beauty of all that God has created. It was Francis Bacon, actually, a great Christian and a great scientist back around 1600, that put words to this idea that there are like two books that God has authored. I put this up on the screen for you. That he says, think of it this way, that God is the author of his word and of his works. Or you could say of his word and of his world. Or on the screen, of scripture, God is the author of scripture, but God's also the author of nature. And if God's the author of both of those things, we should expect that they don't conflict, that they always concord with one another. There's this synergy between the two of those things. That ought to be the case, that we understand both of them as being authored by God. They're aligned. And one of the greatest passages of Scripture, which plays on this idea, and this is where Bacon got it from, that God created his world and it's full of majesty and glory. And also God wrote his word, which is equally full of majesty and glory. And that's Psalm 19. Just listen to this picturesque look at the universe that the psalmist, inspired by the Holy Spirit, as he stares out into the sky and looks at the stars. Here's what he says. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, they use no words, no sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the end of the world. And then he turns just to the sun, and even looking at the sun in our own solar system, he says, in the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. The sun is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber. This picture of on honeymoon night, like the bridegroom comes out of the bedroom after whatever, and it's like beaming, right? Like a champion rejoicing to run his course. The sun rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. That's a picture of this beauty and majesty and greatness of God. When our kids were younger, we were always trying to teach them, how do you love Jesus and love the world that God has created? And one of the illustrations that we found was a video that kind of panned in. It was an artist's conception of everything. And at the beginning of the video, it's looking at the smallest elements that we possibly know in our world. And then it just kind of zooms out and gets bigger and bigger. And pretty soon you're just on the earth and then outside the earth and outside the solar system and then outside the galaxy and just keep going out farther and farther. If you go to the Natural History Museum at University of Michigan, they have something like this. It's an incredible, fun exhibit. You get a big wall, a big video screen, and everything I just described you can do, like just moving your hands in and you can go smaller and smaller and smaller. And then you just move your hands out, you don't touch anything, and you just go out farther and farther and farther to the reaches of the universe. And we would tell our kids, that's the world that God created. That's the universe that God made. That's the majesty of all that he's done. And it's just so cool to think of it that way. Amen? I thought of a different way of approaching that today. One of, if you'll just bear with me for a second. This is a big balloon. I'm going to blow it up. The theory of the Big Bang, as I understand it, is that way back when, this is what science would say, there was a spot smaller than I can even push this balloon together that included all of the mass of the universe. And then suddenly, for no apparent reason, it expanded. It blew up. And so that little spot that I can't even make this small enough to be smaller than that blew up to be the universe that keeps expanding today. Oh, this is bad. Okay, that's enough. It can go a lot bigger. So imagine this. Imagine that this is the universe as it exists now. People don't know the shape of it. There's conjecture. There's conjecture about the size of it. But the agreed upon size of the universe that we can observe today is about 93 billion light years across. You can't even picture that. 93 billion light years across. Let's say that this is the universe, and it actually is in the shape of a balloon like this. The diameter of it is 93 billion light years. Each light year is 6 trillion miles, roughly. So the distance across the universe would be roughly, as far as we know today, 550 billion trillion miles. Half a trillion trillion miles across this universe, and it started from something smaller than this balloon. And we just imagine, like you can imagine, if this is total miscasting, but imagine thinking of me as God and this is the universe I just created. There it is. I spoke, boom. That's unbelievable. That's the majesty that the writer of the Psalms is talking about, that God did all of those things. All of those things. He's the one who creates, the one who holds everything together. I can't help but think, as I'm thinking about this, of the spectacular pictures that we're finally getting from the James Webb Telescope. Anybody been following this? I mentioned it a few weeks back, but I've been so pumped. $10 billion, multiple countries around the world put this together. It actually launched, unfolded, 340-some failure modes that all of them passed. And so we've got this telescope that's peering out into the universe, finally giving us back some pictures. And this is one of the few. I just can't wait for more of them. This is the Carina Nebula, which is a bunch of light years away, but not that far away. And this is what they think is stars get like birthed out of this thing. And from top to bottom in this baby, it's 7 light years. 7 light years, 6 trillion light years, 6 trillion miles, right? 42 trillion miles from top to bottom. I didn't ask permission to tell this story, but you can make fun of Ben later. My son went skydiving a few weeks ago, and he found a great deal on Groupon, because why wouldn't you like find the best deal you can if you're going to skydive for the first time? And so he went on Groupon, and he got this deal for $110. He and a buddy went, and they got to this place where we're going to skydive, and it wasn't at an airport. It was like in somebody's field. It was a grass runway. It was a small plane. The two guys that were taking them up in tandem didn't speak hardly any English, and they still went up, right? And they're alive. They made it. And so he's fallen down. But you can imagine, if you were skydiving in the Carina Nebula and you started at the top of this thing and fell at the speed of light for 7 years, you would keep falling. That's how big this thing is. 7 years at the speed of light, you'd skydive. That would be a rush. I'll just tell you that much. Another picture that's come out from this telescope is the Southern Ring Nebula. Like, I don't know what to say about this other than that God just seems to like showing off. Like, it's so cool. The next picture is, they call this one Stefan's Quintet. It's 5 galaxies. You can't tell from this picture, but some of them are in front of each other. The closest one is only 40 million light years away. The ones behind it are about 290 million light years away. And this is just like unbelievable. The Apostle Paul knew nothing of this. He knew nothing of the beauty of this. All he could see was the night sky painted with stars, a lot more than we could see than we can because of light pollution. But he could just see that, and he described it this way in Romans 1, that for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what he has made so that people are without excuse. In other words, if you can stare out at the sky and see the immensity of all that God has created and not believe that there's something bigger than you, you're not paying attention, bro. Paul's like, come on. God is amazing. The works that God has made. And then here's the thing. The psalmist in Psalm 19 transitions from the majesty of God's world that he's made to the majesty of God's word. And they're equally majestic in his mind. The word of God is beautiful. He continues on in verse 7. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. So you open up God's word and you find yourself being refreshed and made wise and given joy and given light to your eyes. It's beauty and majesty of God's word. He says, hold that up because God's the author of that. And so if I can come back to that picture from Francis Bacon way back in the day, you see, God is the author of both of these books, nature and scripture, his world and his word. And if we believe in the Bible and we believe it's true, then there are two inescapable conclusions that we ought to come to. One is that Christians ought to be the most pro-science people alive. We ought to love digging in and understanding God's world because we believe that he made it and he created it and he sustains it. We ought to love that. And we should also expect that those two books will tell the same story, that there isn't any conflict. And to the extent that there is conflict between these two books that God authored, it's because one or both of those books is being misread. Francis Bacon, when he talked about this idea, said, if God's the one who wrote those two books, then whenever it seems like there's a contradiction, keep pressing on, keep trusting God, keep looking, because in the end, they will agree. Whenever you encounter a problem, keep pressing, keep trusting. See, one thing I understand about Jesus and know about Jesus is that he loves truth. He loves the mind. There was a guy who came to him one time and he said, Jesus, what is the most important commandment? And you know it. You've heard this one before maybe. Jesus said, love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Jesus loves the mind. If you're not yet a Christian, you're just kicking around the edges and exploring a little bit. Here's what I know about Jesus. Here's what I know about the Christian faith. He wants all of you. He wants your mind. You don't check your mind at the door to become a Christian. He wants all of you fully engaged, your heart and soul and mind. And so, why is there a conflict sometimes? Why is there a perceived conflict between those two books? The picture up on the screen is an adaptation from Deb Harzma, who is a PhD in astronomy. Great Christian lady. I've heard her speak two or three different times. She was the chair of the Department of Physics and Astronomy at Kelvin University, like right in our backyard over in Grand Rapids. And she says, even if there's no actual conflict, even though there's no actual conflict, sometimes what happens is there's a misreading of one or the other that causes a possible conflict or a perceived conflict. So in other words, as I say up on the screen, if you have scripture, the data is the same. We all have the same Bible, but we interpret it differently. That's why you have different denominations. Some of those ways that people interpret it are quite a bit different. Some are just minor differences. But at the end of the day, there's the same Bible, but we read it differently depending on our approach and understanding and depth of wisdom and so forth. The same is true of science. The same data is there for everybody, but it can be interpreted differently over time. And so Harzma says what happens is, and the reason there's a conflict, is that people interpret those things differently. Sometimes it's Christians interpreting the Bible wrong. One of the classic cases of this, if you start reading, and it's more complicated than this version I'll give you, but 300-something BC, Aristotle, the Greek philosopher, not a Christian, not Jewish, began to teach that the earth is the center of the universe, that everything revolves around the earth. And that more or less was the view that was held for almost 2,000 years. And so people would come to the Bible and read Psalm 19, verse 6, which I just read for you a second ago, that describes the sun rising at one end of the heavens and making its circuit to the other. And they would say, see, that's confirmation that the earth is the center of the universe. And then Galileo in 1610 pointed his telescope out into the heavens and began to write that the earth actually revolves around the sun. Not only isn't the earth the center of the universe, the earth isn't even the center of our own solar system. The earth revolves around the sun, and people weren't very fond of him trying to change the deal. He's a solid Christian guy. That's the reason he got into this. But he's changing the way people interpret it. And then all of a sudden people realize, well, wait a second. If the earth is not the center and it revolves around the sun, then Psalm 19, we've been reading that wrong. Phenomenologically, in other words, the way I observe it is that when I wake up in the morning, you've used language like this, the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. Is it actually doing that? No, but that's the way it reads. That's the way it seems to us. So sometimes scripture can be read wrong, but sometimes scientific understanding can be wrong. What's accepted as absolute fact today will likely be discarded tomorrow as rubbish. Humble scientists will even acknowledge this. Think about what people believed 100 years ago, or 200 years ago, or 500 years ago, and people think today, man, how foolish was that? Why did they do bloodletting for medicine? I mean, it makes no sense, but it made perfect sense to them. One of the most fascinating books I've come across is by a guy named Thomas Kuhn. It's called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. And in it, he says the way science moves forward is that everyone's working on this particular theory and everyone is contributing to it, but then somebody comes along and they discover something new and they say, you know what, that whole theory is wrong. And then everybody abandons that theory almost overnight, which in scientific terms is maybe 100 years. You have the Copernican Revolution or Euclidean geometry or quantum physics. Every two or three generations, people look back at the ones before and they say, how could they possibly believe that? Like, they actually cut people open when they did surgery. How come they didn't just use their tricorders and just wave it at them? Star Trek fans, anybody? Woo! So one of the reasons, too, that there is perceived conflict is that a lot of scientists, or not a lot, but some, speak out of their lane a bit, if I can say it that way. Guys like Richard Dawkins, who I quoted earlier, will, as a scientist, pontificate as a philosopher as if their philosophical assumptions are based in science. So as a for instance, has science ever proven that the universe has no purpose? No, you can't prove that. Has science ever proven that the universe is just a random machine? See, it's important for us to think about this really clearly because sometimes scientists can speak philosophically and it comes across as truth. And we can buy into it. William Provine is one of these guys. He's passed away now, but he taught at Cornell University. Let me just give you an example. Not to bust on him. I'm sure he was doing the best he could. But here's something he said. Let me summarize my views on what modern evolutionary biology, which is what his field, what it teaches us loud and clear. In other words, this is what modern evolutionary biology proves. There are no gods, no purposes. No goal-directed forces of any kind. There's no life after death. When I die, I'm absolutely certain that I am going to be dead. There's no ultimate foundation for ethics, no ultimate meaning in life, no free will for humans either. That's fine to have that opinion, but just as a matter of scientific inquiry, is there ever been a single double-blind study that's published in a journal that's peer-reviewed that proves any one of those things? No. That's not what those journals are for. That's not the kind of thing that they tried to prove. They don't try to prove that God doesn't exist or that there's no purpose in the universe. He's speaking out of his lane. He's speaking as a philosopher. So sometimes we can get our biblical understanding wrong. Sometimes scientific understanding can be wrong. That's why there's this conflict. But let me summarize this before we move to the myths. The Bible is not intended to be a science textbook. We have to make sure that we are reading and interpreting Scripture the way that the authors of Scripture wrote it and the way that they believed we should understand it and interpret it. At the same time, science can't ever answer questions about whether God really exists, or they can't disprove that there's life after death, or explain even concepts like justice or altruism or friendship. They can't explain those things. So the perceived conflict is when one or the other side overreaches. Are you with me? All right. Yes, we are. We have one person with you. Thank you. Thank you, Piper. All right. Myth number one, that I just want to bust this. Science, Christians are anti-science. This never should be the case. Dawkins, who I quoted at the beginning, said, science is about facts and evidence, but faith is about belief despite the lack of facts or evidence. He believes Christians are anti-science. That shouldn't be the case. Christianity actually fosters science and should foster science and features scientists. Historically, if you read back in the annals of history, science flourished in Christian environments. That's why historically scientific discovery thrives wherever Christianity goes, because scientists were oftentimes, mostly times, believers in Jesus. And they were assured that the universe that they were observing, big or small, was actually ordered and intelligible and worth investigating and actually reflected God's nature itself. And so that's why most of the great scientists in history have been Christians. The notion that science and religion are at war with one another is actually a modern myth. I read listened to a wonderful podcast called Undeceptions by, I forget the name, come afterward and I'll tell you, but he nails down like the people that started to write this in the first place back in the mid-1800s. It's a myth that science and faith have always been at war. Among university professors today in our country, surveys find that when you look at all the different specialties that professors have, among us, the highest percentage of Christians are in the hard sciences, biology, chemistry, physics, things like that. Perhaps it's because they're the ones who know best the limitations of science and spend the most time, whether they actively believe they're doing it or not, they're exploring the vast wonders of creation. Christians ought not to be anti-science. A great book that I read in preparation for today, Rebecca McLaughlin writes in Confronting Christianity. She's got 12 different issues that are hard issues for Christians. Suffering is one, science is one. She writes a chapter on science and faith. And she herself is got her PhD from Cambridge University and names by name in her chapter on science, I hope with permission, professor after professor at universities like Cambridge and MIT and Oxford who are solid Christians in the sciences and explore their faith through the sciences. Christians don't have to be anti-science, and most times are not. I also just started reading an autobiography by a guy named Cy Gart, a PhD professor of biochemistry at Rutgers University. The title of it, as you can see up on the screen, is The Work of His Hands. It's subtitled, A Scientist's Journey from Atheism to Faith. And in his book, he details how, as an adult, as a scientist, teaching science in the university, he comes to find that there are so many questions that he can't answer, philosophical kinds of questions that science can't give him help with. He ends up coming to Christ and writing this autobiography. It's only a couple years old. I'm just starting it. But he asks questions like, and these questions haunt him. Like, why is biological life so complex? If human beings are special, and as a father and grandfather, he recognizes, like, they're special. If that's true, why? How did they get that way? Or how did the universe begin? How did life begin? How did human consciousness arise? Questions that can't be answered by randomness and chance. And so he says this, is a quote from him, as passionately as I tried to follow the path of Jesus, and as fervently as I prayed to God, giving thanks for his blessings in my life, I am equally passionate about the beauty and wonder of our natural world as revealed by the hard work, brilliant ideas, and beautiful synthesis of science. I find that these two passions are complementary and mutually reinforcing. Are Christians anti-science? And I hope not. I hope that that's not us. I have a second myth, though, and this one might challenge us a bit. The second myth is this, that evolution has disproven the Bible. You've heard this one. Maybe you think this one, that somehow If evolution is true, that the Bible can't be true. And we've all read the words or heard the words from Genesis 1, 1 and 2. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty, or formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. It's this beautiful and majestic picture of God creating all things. When we study the Bible, though, we have to understand how the Bible wants to be read, how the authors of Scripture want us to read it. What's the point that they're trying to get across? And you can read lots of different commentators, evangelical commentators, conservative commentators, commentators on Genesis that I've learned from and studied from, commentators who've got their books in my office, who when they look at Genesis and they're trying their best to say, here's God's world that he's created, and here's all the things that we've learned about astronomy and paleontology and biology and chemistry, and here's God's word, and we believe it to be true, we believe it to be inspired and accurate and beautiful and good. As we look at that together, and we only stay in our lane, how do we look at the Bible? They realized, like, the Bible's not a science textbook. It wasn't meant to. It talks about the heart, but it doesn't teach you how to do heart surgery. It talks about the mind, but it doesn't teach you how to do brain surgery. The questions that the Bible is trying to answer are not the questions oftentimes that we put back on it. Because we want to know how long ago did it happen, what was the exact sequence of events that happened. But what if the Bible was never intended to teach us those things? What if the Bible's main purpose was to help us to see that God is bigger than all of this, that God created everything, and that humans actually are special? Because when you start looking back at the creation stories of all the other cultures in the ancient Near East around the time of when Genesis was written and Moses unveiled this by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, what you find was that those cultures would teach a creation story, a creation myth that goes something like this, and they all had very similar angles. That there are multiple gods, that we worship the sun, and we worship the moon, we worship the stars, we worship the weather, we worship all those things, and there are multiple gods. And Moses comes along, and he's trying to say in the book of Genesis, no, there is one God, and he is all-powerful. Yahweh God made all things, not all these other things. And Yahweh God is separate from all those things. He's not in the sun and in the moon. He's higher than those. He's the God. They're just things. The author of Genesis is trying to prove that to people. The author of Genesis is trying to prove that God is outside of creation. He's not in the rocks. He's not in the trees. He is separate from and greater than and the maker of and sustainer of all those things. The reason that the gods in this story created everything is actually also very similar. The reason that gods created human beings is that they realized without human beings, like, they have to do all the work. And so the lesser gods complained to the higher gods and said, we need you to create something that will do the work for us because we don't want to have to keep being your servants. And so the gods created human beings to be the slaves of the gods. All the stories are talking about that. Moses comes along and says, no, that's not why God created the human beings. God, the maker of this universe, created human beings with value. He wanted us to be the vice regents, his image bearers, in this world that go into all of the world and tame the garden that he made and expand and explore and image him to this world. And so one bit by another bit, the author of Genesis is trying to say all those other stories of the creation are false. They're fake. The real story is that the one God created everything and that humans have incredible value in his eyes, which sets up the whole story of the rest of the Bible. That God makes a covenant with human beings that he will be their God and they will be his people, and that human beings rebel and walk away from God, but God never gives up. He never lets up. He continues to pursue all the way to coming to this earth, sending his son Jesus to this earth to give his life for us so that we can have eternal life with him forever. That's the story of the Bible. That's what Genesis is trying to get across according to these evangelical scholars. And so once you see it that way, the questions begin to change. So we want to be truly biblical people, but to be truly biblical people, we have to come to Genesis asking the questions that it wants us to ask. Genesis is addressing these questions that were around back then. Who is God? How did he make us? Why did he make us? Is he the one in charge, or is the sun in charge, or the moon in charge? What's the identity of human beings in this matchless world, this matchless cosmos that God has put us in? In other words, I'm beating this to death maybe, but even conservative evangelical scholars, many of them think that Genesis 1 and 2's purpose is not to describe the actual specifics about the mechanics of creation or how long it took or the role of mutations or not, any of those sorts of things. Those questions weren't around back then. And so in their view, the Genesis account, as it's written, can easily accommodate everything that scientific observation makes about astronomy and biology and paleontology and geology and all those sorts of things. So here's the thing. I'm sitting here in this room with you. I'm saying, and lots of us believe all sorts of different things as we come to Scripture, and I want to honor that. A lot of people believe in this room that God created the earth recently. And a lot of people believe that there's an intelligent designer and somehow it took time to do that. And many believe that God used some of the forces that we might call evolution. But God is the one directing and moving and shaping and actively involved in all those sorts of things. What's the right answer? I don't know. I wasn't around back then. But what I do know is this. That question, your answer to that question, should not be the key determiner of your faith. See, what I'm telling you is this. When people say, what about evolution? Evolution can't be true and Christianity true. All I say is, I know that God is behind creation, and however he did it, God was the one who did it. And God is the one who gives us Christ. The author of Hebrews says this, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, that God was behind creation, that Christ is the center of everything, that Jesus claimed that he was God himself in the flesh. He called people like you and me to believe in him and to follow him and to love him and to trust him and to live life with him, and that Jesus spoke about the deepest needs of human existence. But Jesus never once demands a particular scientific view. That's not what Jesus did. And so the myth is that evolution has disproven the Bible. I don't believe that that's true for a second. Y'all with me? All right, a few more seconds. Three personal reflections, all short. One is just a word to parents. Denise and I, as we were raising each of the kids, wanted to instill in them a love for Jesus, a love for God's people, a love for the church, a love for just following him in every which way. We also wanted to have them have a great education. And so we asked them to read all sorts of different stuff about history and science. We homeschooled them for a bunch of years. And they'll tell you today they're scarred from it. In good ways. I mean, because we just wanted them to learn and grow. And so side by side, we're trying to teach them Jesus and faith and science and how all that mixes together. We want to give you the tools to be able to ask good questions and to learn and to grow in those things. What I've seen some parents do, which is really hard, is to say, there's one view of creation, and if you don't believe that view of creation, you can't possibly be a Christian. And then I've watched lots of teens grow up and hear those words and go off to college and sit in a biology class or whatever and think, wait, they're teaching me that this other thing happened, and there's lots of evidence over here for evolution, and that means I have to choose. I can either believe what I'm hearing and learning and growing in, or I'm not a Christian. I just want to encourage you as parents to help your students, help your kids to grow in understanding and help them understand that their belief in Jesus and trust in Jesus and love for Jesus and worship of Jesus is the main thing. Keep the main thing the main thing. That's just an encouragement. Do with that what you will. But as your pastor, that's my encouragement to us. A second personal reflection for those of you here today who are scientists. You do science. You teach science. You love science. You research. You're involved in engineering or medicine or education or biology or chemistry, physics, neuroscience. There's a bunch of us here. You're doing a super cool thing. You're doing a noble thing. You're thinking God's thoughts after him. The pursuit of science is a very noble and spiritual calling. You're embracing your work as a way of knowing God better, and I love that. You're reading the big book of creation, if you will, alongside the big book of Scripture, and you're trying to obey God's command that was given way back in Genesis to exercise dominion over the universe and to learn about and to be curious about and to discover and to steward the earth. I love that. And those of us like me who are not scientists, I just shake my head. When I find out what some of you do, I'm like, I have no clue what you just said, but that sounds super cool. I'm grateful for you. I admire you. I'm humbled. And I want to cheer you on. We're glad to be together in this church, in our church family. A third personal reflection, this last one. This is for all of us. Let's have humility and charity toward one another on a topic like this. Sometimes people say, why don't you guys address some of the big issues of our day, like tough topics? And then we address them, like this is a tough topic. And if you don't agree with everything that I say, then you're like, why do you do that? Why do you talk about that? Let's have charity. Let's have humility. Whether you consider yourself a person of faith or not, let's be a people who comes humbly together and submit to the truth. This topic, I know, arouses different emotions in you, different anxieties, but no matter what your perspective is, I've probably upset some of you today in lots of ways. You disagree. Let's talk about it. This is the beginning of a conversation, I hope, not the end of one. These are issues that we're all facing. Maybe this is your issue. Maybe it's not your issue, the one that's really passionate about for you. But my prayer is that all of us would approach a topic like this with grace, and we would learn and discover together. Amen? Thank you. That was unexpected grace. Would you bow your heads, and I'm going to close with these words about Jesus. Just listen to these words. Paul, the apostle, and John wrote these about Jesus and related to creation. Paul says this in Colossians, the Son, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Jesus, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through Jesus and for Jesus. Jesus is before all things, and in Jesus all things hold together. And then John, the apostle, a friend of Jesus who walked with him for 3 years on this earth, begins his gospel this way. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word, Jesus, was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through Jesus, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. And the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And so, Father, help every one of us to be open and humble before your truth. How awed we are, how humbled we are by this reality, this universe, in which we find ourselves living. Thank you for Jesus who made it. God, when we think about the fact that Jesus cares about our little lives, that he notices us, that he actually became one of us, that he died on a cross for us to give us hope, how grateful we are. And so we give you our worship. We give you our all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand together. Thank you, Mark. Let's give him our all. We love you, Lord.
Give us hearts without idols, Lord, we worship Jesus. Come on, you know this one.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay. I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful.
of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness. Of the goodness of God, I'm gonna sing. And all my life you have been faithful every day. And all my life you have been so, so good. And every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing.
I'm happy to talk with you guys afterward today or set up a lunch, whatever it is. Let's make this a discussion, not just a monologue. Today, as you leave, though, I want to give you a blessing. If you want to raise your hands, hear these words. If this is our universe again, the same God who made this universe 550 billion trillion years across knows you. He knows every hair in your head. And he says to you, you are my favorite child. Amen and amen. Have a great week, you guys.
believe. And I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. So let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus.